Open source library were once my go-to whenever I get some kind of a problem in my code, or I needed a fast solution, or sometimes I even build my entire code around it. But lately I found out that the small libraries, I'm starting to ditch them. I'm not using them anymore. And I found a better solution using generative AI. So I want to show you today two examples of cases that I just decided not to go with an open source library and actually create my own code to solve the same problem faster, much more secure. So why did I even thought about this episode today? It all started a few weeks ago when in the same week, I saw two different YouTube channels that I really like. One of them was by David Huckley from CodeApps Academy, and the other was by the brilliant Jeff Delaney from Fireship. And both of them talk about the vulnerability that you have when you're using open source libraries and open source solutions. I'm not going to dive into that. I will link those videos in the description, but what I really took for it is when David says that,
however, a chain is only as strong as its weakest link.
Sometimes this piece of weakness can come from an open source and you will have a problem, because most of the people, when they're using open source, they're not diving into the code that this open source is built up. Then some of them don't even track the security issues that this open source have. And that could be a huge, huge problem. When I saw those videos, I was thinking about my own coding. I said, wait, lately I start not using open source code. And I'm not talking about the big platform. I'm talking about small libraries that really help me write code fast that I just decided not to use them at all. So I will give you those two examples in a second. But what made that change? Well, the change was made because recently the way that I'm writing code is completely different than in the past. I'm using generative AI more often. In fact, I have a team of assistants that help me do my job today. And I can be honest and say that most of the code that I'm writing these days, I'm not writing it. There is an assistant that do it for me. I'm actually just managing the process. I'm making sure that everything is okay. I'm more doing code review than write code. And it makes my work much more interesting, much more faster. And I have to admit, the quality is much bigger. I did talk in the past in other videos how I'm doing that. And if you want me to add more example of exactly how I'm writing code today, please write it in the comment. But I just say that when I'm now replacing those open source libraries, I'm getting a code that is tailor-made for my needs. I don't have any stuff in the code that I don't use, which usually happened to me when I'm using open source library. You know, sometimes I only did part of the features, but not the rest of it. And I'm still carrying all the weight of the rest of the features. And it's already connected very, very well to my testing, my logging, my monitoring. Everything is just working perfectly. And it's also written in the same style and tones that the rest of my code is written. So everything is just perfect. So let's jump straight to the first example. The scenario is very basic. I'm using generative AI to return a JSON object that my code could continue in using. The problem is that sometimes the generative model create a huge amount of token to return, but it reached the token limit of the output. So what I got in response was half of a JSON. And if you ever work with JavaScript and with JSON parser, you probably know this error, right? So the parser tried to read the string, tried to convert it into a JSON, but something was wrong, so it couldn't do it, and you got this error. In any other case, I would probably say that this is a huge bug and we have to find a way to fix it. But in this specific case, when I look at the return that I got from the generative model, I saw that I actually got a lot of good information, because my JSON was built from a lot of small parts that I can use in my code. And it was already had enough content that I could actually do something with it and not rerun it again and waste more time and waste more money on tokens. And I said, wait, is there a way for me just to finish this string correctly so I can parse it into JSON? And since I am working with assistants, that was the first thing I wrote to them and says, wait, this is a problem that I want to fix this way. Is there a good solution? And in a few minutes, I already have a function that know how to get a string with a wrong parsing of JSON and fix it, and then introduce it to the JSON parser and get the right result. And when I finish everything and also included automatically unit tests to this, so I have like a full class that doing everything that I need, I thought to myself, wow, that's so cool. I'm sure other developers have the same problem. Maybe I should convert it into an open source library. And I went to Google and I found out that there is already an open source library. And I stopped myself and said, hey, usually I used to do the other way around. I first go to Google, search for a library, and then write the code. But this time it was so seamlessly, I just got the code out. And then I went to that library. And although it's an amazing library, it's actually doing much more than what I need, because they have more features. The fixing, the parsing was only one small part of that library. I don't need the entire thing. I actually stopped and thought, should I replace the code that we just got with this library? Because I'm sure it, I hope, it's more secure, it's already debugged, the community already worked on it, it's written perfectly. But for that, I need to go into the code. I need to start to see how much is the community working on this library. Maybe it's a library that someone wrote a few years ago and forgot about it. I need to do more work here in order to replace it with a code that I already have, that is already tailored to my entire project and is already being tested. And the answer was, yeah, I'm not going to waste more time on it. I'm very happy that the community already have a solution, but mine is more good for me. So that was the end of it. Let me go to the second example, because that's much more complicated. So if you know this graph over here, this is LangGraph. And LangGraph is like a sub-library out of the LangChain family of libraries. If you're not familiar with LangChain, LangChain is an amazing platform that helps developers use generative AI much more easily. And I love LangChain, but I love it for the investigation part, for the research part, and definitely for the prototyping part. But when it's going to production, LangChain could be a nightmare, because LangChain and the entire ecosystem of libraries is so complex and so rapidly developing that you can sometimes find a 3 update version in a week, sometimes even more. Sometimes you can actually find up to 2 updates in a day. And you need to keep up with this entire huge amount of library and with all the dependencies, because each time, even if you're just using part of it, there are so many dependencies of other open source libraries inside of it. It's getting so much complicated into your code. I'm trying to avoid using any of them in my production. So I will use it only in my prototyping time. But then when I know exactly what I want, I will stop using it. And that's had happened to me with LangGraph. So LangGraph is a subset of LangChain that allow you to create agent very, very fast in a brilliant way. Really, I really respect what they did, but it's a new library. It's changing all the time. It's not mature yet. And I won't never put that on any code that I release to production. And I'm working on a project for a customer that need to go to production. So what will I do? And the way I solve it is was very simple. After I did all the preparation and all the research on LangGraph, I took the entire documents of this library and I put it on a new document of mine, and I start removing all the parts that I don't need. I definitely don't need any connection to LangSuite, which is like the monitoring and logging system. I don't need a lot of stuff inside LangGraph, but I did keep the stuff that I need. And I also added new stuff that are more tailored to my solution, because I had new ideas that I said, oh, if I can do this and that here, that actually will be much more smarter, which in the past was probably me joining the community and adding more update to the library, which I might even do now, but I don't need it for my code. So once I finished this document, I went back to my assistants and start doing brainstorming on it and start debating of, is it solid enough? Is it secure enough? How are we going to test it? And the end of this discussion, we actually had a requirement document that explained exactly how to write this code tailored to my project. And this time I gave Claude 3.5 Sonnet to write the code itself. And in 2 days, I had an entire new library that knows how to run my version of, let's say, the LangGraph, which is not exactly LangGraph, but it's more tailored to all the discussion that I already had with the assistants. It was already came with 90% coverage of unit test, and it works amazingly. So in those 2 days, yeah, I had a lot of work to do. Most of it was code review. There were a few bugs. Well, actually, there were more than a few bugs, but every time I found a bug, whether when I was doing code review or whether actually running the code and getting an error, I just went back to the assistant and gave the exactly, this is what happened. Why do you think it's happened? Tell me, how do you think you should solve this problem? And then we had a small discussion. In the end of it, I got a code that I just need to paste back and solve the problem. So in 2 days, I got the entire foundation of this agent working tail to my need without needing the use of LangGraph at all. And that's really amazed me, because in the past, I would probably stick with LangGraph and then start maintaining all the bugs that I'm getting from here, making sure that I'm updating the right kind of library so I don't have any kind of new bugs that coming through times. And that would be a huge amount of work. And now I don't need to do that, nothing, because it's already part of my code. This is something that I will probably keep maintaining, and it's working amazingly. So before I finish, I just want to make this note. I'm still going to use open source libraries. I think they are very, very helpful for me, even in production. But I have another way to do things now that could be more benefit. And I will use it when cases like I'm looking a solution and I'm finding, I already had it, that I found an open source in a different language. So I found a nice open source libraries that are doing exactly what I need in Python, but I didn't find it on JavaScript. So I took the Python library, I took the entire code, I put it into one of the assistant and asked it to convert it to me. And then I got a library that I can actually use in my code, and that was amazing. So that's a nice case of using it. Other cases of using it is when you're getting a huge library that you're actually using only a fraction of functionality. And it's so small functionality, you don't need the entire library. You don't need a dependency. You just need this function working. Yeah, then I can just create this function to work for me in my own code. If you ever work with a big corporate, it happened to me in the past that I got a phone call from a customer security team that says, I'm sorry, you cannot use this library. We have issue with it. Or it also can happen from the legal team. In those cases, I will definitely going to use this method to create my own code. And lastly, when I ever see a library that is update volume is too high, I get suspicious and I wouldn't want to use it in my production code. So I hope I inspired you to think differently about the way you're writing code. If you learned something new, please like, subscribe, and I will see you on the next video.